Okay, earlier we looked at the architecture part of this network. Let's look at the second part. One is the part we are in, the wireless air interface, or we say during 5G. This is a new air interface. On this new air interface, what new enhancement technologies do we have to enable 5G to achieve high speed, low latency, and large connections? Here in the 5G era, we will have some new air interface technologies. Actually, this is in our material yesterday. There is such a picture, but we didn't introduce it in detail. Today, we will take a closer look. In our new air interface, we will have some higher order modulation methods. In this way, we can achieve higher speeds, right? Then we will use this massive MIMO, this large scale multi-antenna technology. We will also use new coding and decoding methods. That is our polar code and LDPC coding. We will also use new waveforms. That is our FOFDM, of course. We will also have a more flexible frame structure. There is this enhanced uplink coverage, this uplink and downlink decoupling technology, including we will use a larger bandwidth to increase the rate. This is all our 5G new air interface, some new technologies that will be used. We use these new technologies to enhance the speed of 5G, reduce the latency of the 5G network, increase the connection capability of the 5G network. Okay, let's take a closer look. These key technologies applied in the new air interface. The first is our air interface's spectral resources. This is what we mentioned yesterday. For us in mobile communications, spectral resources are always the most important. Then our current 5G, the main spectral resources used are sub-6G and millimeter wave. Of course, we are in China at present. It is mainly sub-6G. Some parts of overseas, they will use millimeter waves because the needs are different. In the 3GPP protocol, we divide the spectral resources of 5G into two parts. One is called frequency range. That is our frequency range 1. There is also our frequency range 2. Frequency range 2. Frequency range 1 is our sub-60 band. That is our low frequency. Frequency range 2 is our millimeter wave. That is our high frequency. Low frequency is mainly to ensure our coverage. High frequency is to expand our capacity. Then of course, our low frequency will also be divided into two parts. One is within 3G Hz. We call it sub-3G, 3G Hz to 6G Hz. We call it the C band. So our entire spectral resources, there are these two parts. One is our frequency range 1, one is our frequency range 2. Frequency range 1, we also call it low frequency. Here we call it high frequency. Of course, this frequency range 1, we divided it into sub-3G within 3G Hz and C-band frequency range 2. Actually, it's our millimeter wave. Of course, the C-band will be a mainstream band of our 5G. That is what we often say, 3.5G. This is our 5G spectral resource. Why did we choose the C-band? We will choose millimeter wave because C-band and millimeter wave, we have relatively rich spectral resources within sub-3G. Most of our spectral resources have already been allocated to 2G, 3G and 4G. Available spectral resources, or say available continuous spectral resources, are quite limited. So we mainly put the spectral resources of 5G in the C-band and millimeter wave. Actually, our wireless communication want to increase the speed. The most effective means is to use large bandwidth. Actually, we are very familiar with it. Shannon's formula. Our channel capacity, we know what it equals to bandwidth, right? Multiply. By log 1 plus channel ratio, if we want to increase our channel capacity, what is the most effective means? Increase bandwidth. Want to increase the channel ratio? There is a certain difficulty because after you increase the transmit power for your own cell, your channel ratio is increased, but for other cells, it will cause some interference. So to increase the capacity by increasing the channel ratio, the means is very limited. The most effective means is to increase the bandwidth. So when we go back to the film to see, we see that in 4G, our cell bandwidth is 1.4 megabytes, 3 megabytes. The maximum can only do 20 megabytes. But in 5G, we are in frequency range 1, that is our sub-6G, we can do a maximum of 100 megabytes of cell bandwidth. Of course, you can also choose 80 megabytes, 60 megabytes, but our largest cell can use 100 megabytes of bandwidth. When it comes to FR2, that is our millimeter wave band, you can use 200 megabytes, even 400 megabytes of bandwidth. So each cell or each carrier has a very large bandwidth. So this is also an important means for it to effectively increase the rate 1. So this is the first typical feature of 5G, these large bandwidth. We use large bandwidth to effectively increase cell rate. This is our first. When we are in 5G, we see the smallest. It is 5 megabytes because if we continue to use 1.4 megabytes, 3 megabytes, the speed is very low. Actually, it doesn't make much sense. So we will see when we are in 5G, we removed the 1.4 megabytes and 3 megabytes used in 4G because it doesn't make much sense. But why did we keep 5 megabytes, 10 megabytes, 15 megabytes, 20 megabytes? That is, we will consider what to do in the future, recultivate 4G spectral resources, right? We are going to refarming 4G spectral resources. There is a 5G target network of a certain operator, a spectral discussion of the target network. Actually, this is also a very common principle. We know low frequency, right? For example, we use 900 megabytes to do basic coverage here. That is, no matter if you are in the countryside urban area, dense urban area, there will be a 900 megabytes band. We will have a 900 megabytes band. There will be a 900 megahertz signal. Create a basic coverage layer. Ensure you have access anytime, anywhere. There will be a 5G signal, another one. But the bandwidth of the large and small cells of the basic coverage layer might be quite limited, right? It could be 10 megahertz, 5 megahertz, 10 megahertz, 20 megahertz. The cell bandwidth is very limited. And we might have 900 megahertz resources at first glance. It can only be an FDD. So this is the basic coverage layer. We use low frequency for coverage. Next, we will create a 5G capacity and coverage, a relatively balanced 5G coverage layer, or say the previous 4G capacity layer. For example, we use 1.8G or the original 2.1G. This frequency band as our basic capacity and coverage layer, here we can use some of these in dense urban areas. We can use some 4T4R ordinary urban areas, can use 2T2R, use such multi-SKI technology, use 4T4R in dense urban areas, can effectively increase our capacity. Finally, in some of these call hotspot areas, right? In such dense urban areas, we are considering using C-band. We know this C-band, use this C-band to do such. Some hotspot capacity deployments, or deployment of the hotspot capacity layer to ensure in such dense urban areas, we have enough capacity. So this is a typical coverage. An introduction to the coverage target of a frequency band, right? For us, with a high demand for capacity, it might be more of a consumer-oriented service. For these kinds of IoT services, we might just need coverage. Its requirements for speed or capacity will not be particularly high. This is our typical target network introduction. When we mention a technology called Cloud AIR 2.0 here, it is used to share air interface resources. It's such an air interface. Air interface spectrum resources can be shared by 2G, 3G, 4G, and 5G, can be concurrent. Achieve such a spectrum resource sharing. When we say the main frequency band of 5G is C-band, let's take a look at the coverage of the C-band here actually. The coverage of the C-band, we can take a look actually, it is quite, the coverage radius is relatively low, right? We take this typical urban area as an example, right? Typical procedure, if you want to achieve a downlink of 10 Mbps uplink, Mbps coverage requirement. Based on this 3.5G C-band frequency band, its cell radius can probably do downlink. We can do 750 meters. Uplink can only do 300 meters. So the downlink coverage will be better than uplink coverage. Because when we downlink, there is this 64T64R technology. We send through 64 channels to effectively improve this downlink coverage. If you want to achieve in the city, achieve this downlink 50 Mbps uplink, 5 Mbps speed requirement, the coverage radius will be smaller, shrink to 600, uplink 200. If in some dense urban areas, you want to achieve this downlink 50 Mbps uplink 5 Mbps speed requirement, coverage will shrink to within 215 meters. Now we see if we are in this dense urban area, want to achieve this high speed uplink and downlink, use a C band for coverage, cell radius might all be around 300 meters or less than 300 meters. And the uplink will be worse, may not even reach 100 meters. So this is a feature of C-band coverage. How do I solve this problem of weak uplink coverage? Huawei proposed an uplink and downlink decoupling technology. When our terminal is close to the base station, our uplink and downlink both use 3.5G C-band to ensure my capacity. But if the terminal moves to the edge of the cell, we can still guarantee downlink coverage because the downlink antenna, we are 64 channel transmission. We will bring some gain in this way. The downlink coverage is still good at this time. I still use the 3.5G band for downlink, but I switch the uplink to a lower frequency. For example, I switch to 1.8G. In this way, the benefit brought about is that when I am at the edge of the cell, we use 3.5G for downlink. Uplink, we use 1.8G. If you are at the edge of the cell, both downlink and uplink use 3.5G. This will produce a 13.7 dB coverage difference. How do I solve the weak uplink? Coverage is when at the edge of the cell, let the user switch the uplink to 1.8G because we know 1.8G is a lower frequency band. Its coverage will be better. to ensure this uplink and downlink balance through this uplink switch to 1.8G. If you use this 4 antenna, use 4 antennas to receive on the network, we can enhance the uplink by 10.6 dB compared 10.6 dB and gap value 13.7 dB, we can basically make up for the weak uplink coverage difference. So this is our uplink and downlink. The gain brought by decoupling technology, it can significantly enhance our uplink coverage. Compensate for the uplink coverage problem of our cell edge users. Of course, the uplink and downlink decoupling technology requires the support of our mobile phone baseband chip. For example, Huawei's Balong 5000 baseband chip supports uplink and downlink decoupling technology. Currently, 250 meters. Now we see, if we are in this dense urban area, want to achieve this high-speed uplink and downlink, use C-band for coverage. Cell radius might all be around 300 meters or less than 300 meters. And the uplink will be worse, may not even reach 100 meters. So this is a feature of C-band coverage. How do I solve this problem of weak uplink coverage? Huawei proposed an uplink and downlink decoupling technology. When our terminal is close to the base station, our uplink and downlink both use 3.5G C-band to ensure my capacity. But if the terminal moves to the edge of the cell, we can still guarantee downlink coverage. Because the downlink antenna, VR64 channel transmission, we will bring some gain in this way, the downlink coverage is still good. At this time, I still use the 3.5G band for downlink, but I switch the uplink to a lower frequency. For example, I switch to 1.8G. In this way, the benefit brought about is that when I'm at the edge of the cell, we use 3.5G for downlink. Uplink, we use 1.8G. If you are at the edge of the cell, both downlink and uplink use 3.5G. This will produce a 13.7 dB coverage difference. How do I solve the weak uplink coverage is when at the edge of the cell, let the user switch the uplink to 1.8G, because we know 1.8G is a lower frequency band. Its coverage will be better to ensure this uplink and downlink balance. Through this uplink switch to 1.8G, we can through. If you use this, use four antennas to receive on the network. We can enhance the uplink by 10.6 dB compare. 10.6 dB and gap value 13.7 dB, we can basically make up for the weak uplink coverage difference. So this is our uplink and downlink, the gain brought by decoupling technology. It can significantly enhance our uplink coverage. Compensate for the uplink coverage problem of our cell edge users. Of course, the uplink and downlink decoupling technology requires the support of our mobile phone baseband chip. For example, Huawei's Balong 5000 baseband chip supports uplink and downlink decoupling technology. Currently, Qualcomm's X50 chip does not support uplink and downlink decoupling technology. This is our uplink and downlink decoupling. Of course, we will also have some other means to improve our uplink coverage. So for example, we will also have some super uplink technology to improve our uplink weak coverage problem to solve the problem of weak uplink coverage. This is our coverage problem. We solve it through uplink and downlink decoupling. Of course, we will also have a super uplink technology to solve the problem of weak uplink coverage. Another one, we want to improve our business rate. Another means it involves the use of higher order modulation technology. We know about modulation and demodulation. It is one of the very important basic technologies in our wireless communication in the 4G era. Our uplink and downlink can use modulation and demodulation technology. For example, our downlink can use QPSK 16QAM. Of course, in our new standards, we have also defined the 256QAM modulation technology. But there may not be many terminals that can support 256QAM modulation now. There are not many terminals when uplinking. We can only support QPSK, 16QAM and 64QAM. This is what we could support in the 4G era, the modulation methods we could support. For example, if we take 64QAM as an example, we have a symbol. What can it carry? 6 bits of information. If you use QPSKO, your symbol can only carry 2 bits of information. Of course, if you use 256QAM, a symbol can carry 8 bits of information. When it comes to 5G, our uplink and downlink can both support 256QAM modulation. Uplink 256QAM modulation might be used less. Including in the future, we will also use 1024QAM modulation. Of course, this will be defined in subsequent protocol versions to define higher order 1024QAM modulation. Of course, our 5G. It introduces such higher order on the basis of being compatible with 4G modulation methods, introduce such higher order. right? 256 QAM including, in the future, we will introduce 1024 QAM modulation method. Of course, our modulation method is not unchangeable, right? We will also adapt according to the signal conditions of the mobile terminal to flexibly adapt the appropriate modulation method. When our terminal is close to the base station, then use a higher order modulation method to achieve higher business rates. Of course, if our terminal is at the edge of the cell, we can no longer use higher order modulation methods, because when you use higher order modulation methods, the network side may not be able to distinguish it. So we will appropriately use lower order modulation methods to ensure reliability. So the selection of this modulation method, it is also a dynamic process. We can be in a reliability and effectiveness will achieve a balance. Why do we say that 256 QAM modulation? It requires better channel conditions. In fact, we can also see it through the channel diagram under the condition of 256 QAM modulation. We have many different symbols. What between them, the interval or the spatial distance will be very small. If we have a little bit of interference, the network side will not be able to distinguish who are these two symbols. So under the premise of this 256 QAM modulation, we need to have better channel conditions. We can use it if your channel conditions are not very good. Can only use this lower order modulation method to ensure reliability. This is what we can use in the 5G era, some higher order modulation methods that can be used to enhance our rate.